Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Inshallah, before we begin, I would request all of the brothers that are sitting towards the middle or towards the back, inshallah, please move forward and fill in all the gaps, inshallah. Please move forward and fill in all the gaps. It is the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to request that you sit closest to the imam. And it is from a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that anyone who, on the day of Jum'ah, he gets himself prepared by making his ghusl. He prepares his body, cleans himself, puts on beautiful clothing, puts on atar, puts on a fragrance for himself, then comes to masjid early and sits closest to the imam. It's stated that the mercy of Allah, the rahmah of Allah on the day of Jum'ah will descend on this person first, and then it will go to the rows behind him. So inshallah, we should make it a sunnah, we should make it our own agenda that we try to come early and we try to come sit in the front, inshallah. Jazakallah khair. Alhamdulillah, alhamdulillah, nahmaduhu wa nasta'inuhu wa nastaghfiruhu wa nu'minu bihi wa natawakkalu alayhi. Wa na'udhu billahi min shururi anfusina wa min sayyi'ati a'malina. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن سيدنا وحبيبنا محمدًا عبده ورسوله عما بعد فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى في القرآن المجيد بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم هذا بلاغ للناس لينذروا به وليعلموا أنما هو إله واحد وليذكر أولو الألباب وأيضا قال سبحانه وتعالى أفلا يتدبرون القرآن أم على قلوب أقفالها قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إنها ستكون فتنة قال الصحابة رضي الله تعالى عنهم أجمعين ما المخرج منها يا رسول الله قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كتاب الله فيه نبأ ما قبلكم وخبر ما بعدكم وحكم ما بينكم هو الفصل ليس بالهزل أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام صدق الله العظيم وصدق رسوله النبي الكريم ونحن على ذلك لمن الشاهدين والشاكرين والحمد لله رب العالمين رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي اللهم سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. My dear respected brothers, sisters and elders in Islam, first and foremost we give thanks to Allah Azza wa Jal, whom from His infinite mercy has granted you and I the ability to join in the gathering of Yawm al-Jum'ah. My dear brothers and elders in Islam, today, if a person decides to go visit the White House, there are certain protocols and procedures that must be met. You must make sure that your name is on the ballot and on the request forms before you go. Then they do a thorough background check to make sure that you are not a threat, that you are not a terrorist, and in some cases that you're not even Muslim. So they do a very thorough background check before they even consider bringing you into the White House, which is what? A simple house. But my dear brothers and elders in Islam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for one of the greatest places on the face of this earth, a masjid, a place of sajda and ibadah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took your names and my name and put that together and did His own version of a background check, which is what? Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, O those of you that have iman, إِذَا نُودِيَ لِلصَّلَاةِ مِنْ يَوْمِ الْجُمْعَةِ فَاسْعَوْا إِلَىٰ ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ وَذَرُوا الْبَيْعِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did His own version of the background check to do what? To make sure that we are qualified to come to masjid based on what? The criteria of the Quran, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He places forward a commandment. Allah wants to see if we are meeting our part of that agreement. So Allah is saying, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, O those of you that have iman, إِذَا نُودِيَ لِلصَّلَاةِ مِنْ يَوْمِ الْجُمْعَةِ, when the call for Jum'ah is made, when the time of Jum'ah is near, فَاسْعَوْا إِلَىٰ ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ, Come and join in the remembrance of Allah. Run and rush and put your names in the ballot so that you can be amongst those that will enjoy what? Dhikrillah, the remembrance of Allah. The reminder of who Allah is. The nourishment of your own iman. So alhamdulillah, it is not a mere fact that we woke up in the morning, we felt healthy, we were able to take time off from work. That is not the determination for why you are here. It is not based on the fact that you have a beautiful car and alhamdulillah it drove in this direction and all of these other things that factor in. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was looking at the iman of every single person sitting here, and He is the one that decided how valuable we are and the fact that we deserve to be here. It is from the choice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Today, my dear brothers and elders in Islam, everything that we are doing, every action that we perform is based upon the things that we ourselves claim to achieve. For example, when you are going to work in the morning, when we are reaching our workplace, when our coworkers ask us, either you're very early today or you're very late, what do we say? I drove very fast. The traffic was much better. The traffic was slowed down. There was an accident on the road. That's why I came early. That's why I came late. We are basing it on every single thing that we see in this world. But my dear brothers and elders in Islam, we consistently forget to mention that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was the one that has delayed me. He is the one that has brought me early. He is the one that is stipulating what happens in my life and at what point. Today, the reason why we are living in so much stress, the reason for why we are consistently having problems within our own family systems, within our own communities, within the world, is because we consistently believe that it is me that's doing it and I need to find a solution. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He mentions in the Holy Quran that every single thing that Allah has created, مَا أَصَابَ مِن مُصِيبَةٍ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَلَا فِي السَّمَاءِ إِلَّا فِي كِتَابٍ مِّن قَبْلِ أَن نَبْرَأَهَا إِنَّ ذَلِكَ عَلَى اللَّهِ يسير. Allah is mentioning that, oh insan, I'm the one that created you, but understand that after creating you, I'm not just leaving you by yourself. I'm not letting you play around in a sandbox and while I go to the side and just allow you to do whatever you want. No, Allah is saying that I have put things in place for you. I have put tests in place for you. I have put tribulations in place for you. I have put all of these different things, the good news in your life, the bad news in your life, moments in your life where your iman is going to shake and be tested. I, Allah, have already stipulated those things. I, Allah, have already written those things before I even created the heavens and the earth. That is who Allah is, my dear brothers and elders in Islam. Today we have become very detached from the deen of Allah. So what is the main purpose? What is the understanding? What is the entire thing that we need to take from this Jumu'ah? And we don't say that what is it that we need to take from Islam, because Islam is very, very beautiful and it's very large. You can take many points from Islam and beautify your life through it. You can take many points from Islam and beautify your life through it. What do we need to learn this Jum'ah? What do we need to adapt this Jum'ah? What is the point that we can take after we leave from this gathering until the next Friday that I will adopt in my life to make myself better? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he mentions to the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'een, he says, the innaha satakun fitna. Verily you will be tested. Verily you will be tested. The ulama explain that al-fitna, in this particular part of the hadith, it refers to two things. Number one, it's something that's going to be testing your religion. It's going to test your iman. It's going to test how sincere you are to your deen. And number two, it's going to be a personal test, a personal trial. So number one, it's going to be a test which comes over everyone that follows the deen of Islam. Now today, are we coming near that point? Yes or no? We are coming near that point? Yes or no? We're coming near that point. We won't say that that's what it is just yet. We're coming near that point where the entire ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the entire ummah of Muslims today, are being tested regarding their deen and their religion. My dear brothers and elders in Islam, we have been making so much of a ruckus because Donald Trump said so and so that we should not allow Muslims to enter into the United States. And you have a lot of people that are saying, well, he's crazy. Muslims are saying, oh, this is the problem and that's the problem. Go back to Quran and Sunnah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned that this is going to happen. Innaha satakun fitna. Where is our iman? Is our iman within what these people are doing or within the actual words of the man who has never lied? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he already mentioned this. It should not be surprising to us that our deen, our religion is going to be attacked. It's going to be made mention. It's going to be defamed. It's going to be dishonored. It's going to be pushed to the side. That is a promise of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now imagine, at a time when the Sahaba, when the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, now they are ruling all of Arabia. When these words were spoken, the ulama explained, the Muslims were in power at that time. They were not the weak little community that's in Mecca trying to survive and not tell the people that they're praying Salah. No, the Muslims were a powerhouse. They were a superpower in the world. That's when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned this particular thing according to some ulama. Now imagine the Sahaba being told that yes, you are a superpower, but a time will come when your deen and the deen of every Muslim will be tested. Your iman and the iman of every Muslim will be tested. Now imagine the Sahaba could have easily said, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, how close is this to us? It seems like it's something far away. We're a superpower right now. Who's going to touch us? Who's going to mess with us when we have the likes of Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala an, when we have the likes of Umar al-Faruq radiallahu ta'ala an, when we have the likes of Ali radiallahu ta'ala an, we have Khalid bin Walid, the greatest general of Islam, the greatest general when it comes down to warfare, period. Who is going to challenge us? Who is going to speak anything ill of the Muslims? Nobody. What did the Sahaba immediately ask? They said, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what will take us away from this fitna and give us najah? What is going to remove these fitnas from us? What is going to help us when these fitnas or these fitan are upon us? That was their question. They did not question the fact that this would happen. Today it's happening, yet we're still questioning the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Today we are going through the same things that the Quran is speaking about, and yet we're still questioning the ayat of Quran. Today we are facing the same problems that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned that they are going to happen, but today we are neglecting the solutions that he gave to us by trying to solve the problems ourselves. Because why? We believe in our mind that everything that's around us is being controlled by us, and we don't believe in the ayah that I recited in the beginning where Allah is saying, مَا أَصَابَ مِن مُصِيبَةٍ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَلَا فِي السَّمَاءِ إِلَّا فِي كِتَابٍ مِن قَبْلِ أَن نَبْرَأَهَا. That everything that you see, all the problems, the tribulations, I, Allah, have already destined those things to happen. It is a test for mankind. It is a test for you and I. It is to validate our entry into Jannah or our entry and our abode into Jahannam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. That is the purpose. This dunya is not supposed to be a place of continual peace. That is al-Jannah. This dunya is going to be a place where your iman is going to be tested. Your life is going to be tested. Your hunger and your stomach will be tested. Your sabr will be tested. Your istiqamah will be tested. That is the purpose of this dunya. This dunya is meant to attain your akhirah. This dunya is not meant to be al-Jannah for us. That is not the purpose of this world. That is not the purpose with which this dunya was created. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is mentioning, وَإِلَى اللَّهِ تُرْجَعُ الْأُمُورِ. You feel like you were dishonored. You feel like injustice was done to you in this world. Don't worry. Everything will come back to Allah, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will judge between you. Everything will come back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Everything will have to answer in the court of Allah. You don't believe me? Allah is saying in the Quran, Allah points to the questioning of all of the anbiya. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala questions Nuh alayhi salam regarding if he spread his message to his people. We know the story very well. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will question Ibrahim alayhi salam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will question Isa ibn Maryam alayhi salam. Where Allah mentions in the last page of Surah Al-Ma'idah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask, إِذْ قَالَ اللَّهُ يَا عِيسَى بْنَ مَرْيَمْ أَأَنْتَ قُلْتَ لِلنَّاسِ اتَّخِذُونِي وَأُمِّيَ إِلَاهَيْنِ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ. That, O Isa, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will put his own prophets to trial. For what? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to establish justice. This dunya is not going to give you justice. This dunya is not going to give you peace. This dunya is not meant for you to be secure and safe. It is not meant for you to become millionaires and billionaires. If Allah gives you the wealth, use it for the sake of Allah. Spread it to other people. But that wealth will diminish. That wealth will be passed on. That wealth will be consumed. That is the purpose of this dunya. My dear brothers and elders in Islam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on that day will question every single human being regarding what they did in this world. This world is not for anything except for attaining our akhirah. It is not meant for any other purpose than to attain al-akhirah. That is the purpose of this dunya. That is the reason for why we have been sent into this world. My dear brothers and elders in Islam, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told the Sahaba radiyallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'in, that verily, innaha satakun fitna, verily, fitna will come upon my ummah, whether it is the fitna of amma, meaning an incumbency fitna over all Muslims, or khasa, which is particular to every person. You will either face a fitna which consumes the community of Muslims, or you will face a fitna which just has to do with you. There's a particular type of tribulation that you will face, but the people around you will not face. It's a particular problem that will come across only you. And those, again, are very difficult at times, depending on what they are. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam explains regarding both types. What does he say? When the Sahaba ask him that, Ya Rasulullah, what will save us from this fitna? What does he say? He says, Kitabullah. He says what? Do we know what kitab this is? Is it the algebra book? Is it the chemistry book? Is it the book of medicine? What book are we talking about? Al-Quran. It's very easy to say. Now ask yourself, when's the last time we read Al-Quran? All day today, when's the last time we read Al-Quran? Today, to read something, you don't need a book. You can open up your iPad or your tablet or your phone. You're able to read the news. How many times today did we read CNN? Did we read some news network? Did we read Yahoo? Or did we read MSNBC? And how many times did we read Quran? Have we even opened the Quran all of today? What about yesterday? What about from last week till today? Have we opened this Quran? We need to judge ourselves and ask that if we know that there is truth to the words of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, why is it that we are failing, that we are not trying to achieve the success by reading this Quran? Why are we running away from the Quran? Why are we abandoning the Quran? In the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He mentions those people that will put the Quran behind their backs. He mentions that the anbiya and the prophets to whom these kitabs were sent, including the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, on the day of Qiyamah, he will stand as a witness against his own people. He will stand as a witness against his own people. Do you and I want to be at the other side of this particular injunction? How many of us want to be the defendant against the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? How many of us want to have to defend ourselves on the day of Qiyamah for why we did not follow al-Islam? Yet today, as Muslims, our own co-workers do not know we're Muslim. Our own relatives, they don't see us praying our salah. We're not practicing Muslims. We follow certain things and we abandon other things. My dear brothers and elders in Islam, we've heard many bayans about the forgiveness of Allah. But where is us asking for forgiveness? Are we actually trying to make our lives better? The Prophet ﷺ, he says, كُلُّ بِنِ آدَمُ خَطَّى, that every child of Adam, every son of Adam, every man that is born and woman that is born into this world will commit crimes and commit sins. وَخَيْرُ الْخَطَّائِينَ التَّوَّابُونَ, the best of those that commit sins are those that come back and do tawbah. Those are the best of the people. So what does that mean? If everyone commits sins, who is the best of man at that point? Is the one that goes back to Allah and does tawbah, tries to rectify his mistakes. But how many sins we've been doing for so long, yet we have never asked Allah to forgive us. And if we have asked Allah to forgive us, we went back to it and never did tawbah again. We never did tawbah again. To us, unfortunately, tawbah is something that happens in the middle of Ramadan with the lights off at the Khatm al-Quran or Khatm al-Tarawih time. My dear brothers and elders in Islam, who is more foolish? Who is more foolish? We have the answers that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to us in this Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran, هَذَا بَلَاغٌ لِلنَّاسِ. This Quran, it is a balagh, it is a communication from Allah, linnas, to mankind. لِيُنظَرُوا بِهِ وَلِيَعْلَمُوا أَنَّمَا هُوَ إِلَهُ وَاحِدٌ. Use this Quran to warn the people. Use this Quran to teach the people. Use this Quran to highlight what is good and what is evil. My dear brothers and elders in Islam, وَلِيَعْلَمُوا, to let mankind know, to let people understand, أَنَّمَا هُوَ إِلَهُ وَاحِدٌ. Every man, every woman, every child, and every creature was created by إِلَهُ وَاحِدٌ, by one being, by one Allah. وَلِيَذَّكَّرَ أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ. And in doing this reminder, you will remind those that have a lub. They have intellect. When you see people being affected by this reminder, when you see people being affected by this Quran, Allah is calling them people of intellect. So today, are we intellectuals or are we dummy people? Are we idiots? I don't like using those type of terms. But are we intellectuals or are we people that are dumb, deaf, and blind? The Quran has every answer, yet today, when it comes down to our own parties at home, when it comes down to our own gatherings, where are we following the teachings of the Quran? Where are we following the teachings of the Sunnah? My dear brothers and elders in Islam, today we have made this to be a joke. It is time for us to return back to Quran and Sunnah. Why? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He asks a simple question. أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنِ أَمْ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبٍ أَقْفَالُهَا. Have you not pondered upon the Qur'an? Have you not learned and understood and tried to contemplate regarding the verses of the Qur'an? أَمْ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبٍ أَقْفَالُهَا. Or have your hearts been sealed up? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not seal up our hearts. Have our hearts been sealed up to the Qur'an, to the actual meaning? My dear brothers and elders in Islam, I would like to mention a story about selling your deen. This is a very famous story that I just heard from one of the ulama who came from London. He was mentioning that his sheikh was explaining this story about a man, about an imam, who would go and he would, he joined a new community, a new locality to be an imam. So every day he would leave from his home, catch a bus, and the bus would take him and it would drop him in a particular area close to masjid, and he would walk to masjid, lead his salah. After salah would be done, he would walk to the bus station again, get on the bus, go home. Bus would drop him off and he would go home. That's what his entire day was. So one day this imam, he's going and he meets, you know, he's going on the bus for so long, you get to know the driver. So this time is a brand new driver. It's not even the same driver. So the imam, he pulls out the money and he gives it to him. And the bus driver takes the money and gives him his change. And the imam goes to the back and he sits down. What he doesn't realize is that the bus driver, he gave him an extra 20 cents. 20 what? 20 cents. Right? That's the tip that we leave sometimes. at restaurants, when we don't like the server, what do we give? We give 20 cents. We give 50 cents. We give a dollar if we don't like who this, you know, service. Subhanallah. 20 cents. 20 pennies. Now think about that. 20 pennies. How valuable is that today? Absolutely nothing. So he accidentally gave this 20 cents. The imam notices when he goes to the back, he pulls out the money and he's counting, putting it into his wallet. He notices that there's an extra 20 cents that's given to him. So now the imam is thinking to himself that, you know what? It's 20 cents. It's how much? 20. I'm making sure that you know the number because it's very silly. It's only 20 cents. So he's thinking to himself, it's only 20 cents. What is 20 cents going to give me? I can't buy anything with it. Maybe a couple of years back, 20 cents would have at least gotten me a case of Coca-Cola. Today, it buys me nothing. So now, this imam, he's struggling inside. He's thinking, should I go up and mention, what if the bus driver says, oh, you're so weird, man, it's only 20 cents. What if he thinks I'm weird for giving? See, he's struggling inside. He's not sure what he needs to do. Finally, they get to his bus stop. And he thinks to himself, he said, you know what? I need to do the right thing. So he goes up to the bus driver as he's about to exit and he gives him the 20 cents. He says that, you know, sir, you gave me 20 extra cents. The bus driver looks at him. He says, no, I didn't. He says, for the past 10 years, I've been contemplating about Islam. I've been thinking about Islam. Today, when I saw you, I realized that you are either a sincere follower of Islam or you're an imam of this mosque that's close by. Either way around, I wanted to see the truthfulness of Islam. I wanted to see what Islam is. My dear brothers and elders in Islam, he didn't want to read the Quran. He didn't want to read a book on a'mal. He didn't want to read a book of hadith. What did he want to see? He wanted to see practicality. He wanted to see a Muslim being a Muslim. He wanted to see a person following the Sunnah, following this Quran, not reading the book itself, following the teachings of this Quran. He said, I gave you those 20 cents to see if you would return it back to me, to see if it was truthful or not, if this religion is trustable or not. Immediately, this imam started to cry. He started to cry. So the bus driver, he says, why are you crying? He says, I almost sold Islam for 20 cents. For 20 cents, this bus driver accepted Islam. This imam starts to cry. He says, I almost sold Islam for 20 cents. Today, how much are we selling our deen for? How easy is it for us to not pray our salah in the morning? Or not go to the masjid, or not participate in giving zakah, or completely put Ramadan behind our backs and show up the last couple of nights. How easy is it? When someone asks us, are you going to go for Hajj? You say, inshallah, when I get old. Yet we have no savings plan for it. Yet we have savings plan for our retirement. We have savings plan for our kids so that they can go to college. We have savings plans for our grandchildren and our kids are still in school. They're still in elementary school and middle school. We have savings plan for our next 14 generations, mashallah. Where is Islam? Islam is not in the book itself. Quran is not in the book itself. Islam is not in the books of hadith. Islam is not in the books of ta'aleem. Islam is not in the books that are written by scholars and ulama. My dear brothers and elders in Islam, those books are meant to educate us so that we can actually practice Islam, because Islam is living within every action that we perform. That is al-Islam. That is the deen. My dear brothers and elders in Islam, next time we want to commit a crime, commit a sin, commit anything that goes against the will of Allah, think for a moment that if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asks me that what is your Islam, and he asks me about this particular sin, how will I tell my Allah that, oh Allah, this sin that I committed is part of Islam? How will I defend myself? Can I defend myself? My dear brothers and elders in Islam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to you and I a very great opportunity with all of the oppression that is happening. I personally, for those of the brothers that know me, I don't like speaking about anything related to politics. I absolutely disregard anything that has to do with politics. So when it comes down to voting for Obama or voting for Romney, or people said, you know, what do you prefer? I said, I don't ask me. I have no clue. I don't know what they stand for. And that's none of my business. And when it comes down to talks, I believe that we should leave these things out. But in this particular regards, when the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam are being denounced, they're being dishonored, they're being made mention of, that we are polluting society, let's ask for a moment, what can be our response? Don't try to go and hold rallies and protests and requests that somebody ask for forgiveness, or we need an apology from Mr. Trump. We need nothing except for us to show the people what Islam is. If you go and you find that you are practicing Islam, that is the best form of da'wah that you and I can give. My dear brothers and elders in Islam, a person came to Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha and asked that, oh Mother Aisha, can you tell us what was the akhlaq of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? What was the akhlaq? What was the characteristic? How would he, you know, what determined what he did, you know? Because we know that he's married. So in marriage, you have arguments, you have those type of disputes. During disputes, did he get really hot-headed? Did he get really angry? Or did he, you know, did he try to quell the wife? Like, how, what determined what he did? In what situation did he do this? What situation did he do this? So Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she says, stop, hold on. Your question was, what was the akhlaq of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? She said, have you not read the Quran? Have you not read the Quran? Have you not recited the Quran? He says, yes. Ana hafiz, I'm a memorizer of the Quran. And I also did the ta'aleem of Quran. I know the tafsir of the Quran. I also know the sunnah of the Prophet. She said, no. Have you read the Quran? He says, yes, I read the Quran. He says, his akhlaq was the Quran. His akhlaq was the? How many of our akhlaq is Quran? And I raised my hand as you saw, and I put it down immediately. Huh? This starts with myself. We need to question ourselves. Who can actually mention that this brother right here, mashallah, this person right here, his akhlaq reminds me of the Quran? How many of us can say this? That his lifestyle reminds me of the Quran? Being huffaz, being ulama, or knowing Surah Al-Fatiha, Surah Al-Nas, all of these surahs from within the Quran, if it does not change what we do and who we are, my dear brothers and elders in Islam, our hearts have been sealed by Allah against this Quran. We ask Allah that, oh Allah, you open our hearts to this Quran. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that, oh Allah, enable us to practice the deen of Islam. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that, oh Allah, enable us to practice upon the teachings of Al-Quran and the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. My dear brothers and elders in Islam, today, because of these statements that are going on about the Muslims, there are people holding rallies, there are people holding all of these different types of things. What I suggest and what I follow amongst the teachings of Al-Islam is what? Number one, that when you are in trouble, when you are going through depression and oppression, when you are going through trials and tribulation amongst all of these people that are non-Muslims, they're trying to understand Islam, but they've never seen Islam. What does Allah say at first? وَاعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا. First and foremost, don't try to fix the problems of the world. As Muslims, come together, sit together, unify yourselves first. وَاعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا وَلَا تَفَرَّقُوا. And do not divide yourselves. That's number one. As Muslims throughout the country, throughout the world, we need to unify ourselves. Do not make divisions. Do not make different groups and sections and denominations. Join together as one ummah. Don't blame one group for doing this and doing that. My dear brothers and elders in Islam, come together as Muslims. Do not allow that our differences break us away from the deen of Islam. وَلَا تَفَرَّقُوا. Then after you have solidified as one ummah, what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say? وَذْكُرُوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكُمْ. Remind yourselves and remember what Allah has done for you and practice upon those reminders. When you know that Allah has done so many good things to you, Would we not do good things back for the sake of Allah? That is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has programmed us. My dear brothers and elders in Islam, my sincere request to this community, to every community, to myself and to all of the members of the communities here in Atlanta and all over the world, it is to come together as one ummah. Do not fall prey to all of these things that are happening. Our job is not to respond to them. Our job is to respond to our Allah. And how do we respond to our Allah? By following the teachings and the commandments by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the ones that Allah has sent in the Quran, and by following the sunnah and the footsteps of Muhammad al-Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the soft heart of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the akhlaq of the Quran. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enable us to teach mankind about Islam in the proper way by practicing it ourselves. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enable us to be forgiven for the shortcomings within our lives. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enable this moment to be a transformation within our lives so that we can change ourselves and give da'wah to everyone that comes. You don't need to stand up in the middle of the bus and say, believe in Allah, there's only one God. You're going to scare people. You're going to scare people. You have to know how to speak to the people. How do you deal with people? Be kind. Be courteous. When people throw smirks, when people are throwing frowns and angry looks at you, what do you do back to them? Smile. Why? Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says it is a form of sadaqah. When people are trying to harm you, do good to them. Why? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says, go back to the Quran. What does Quran say? That man ja'a bil hasana falahu ashru amthaliha. Anytime something bad happens to you, anytime anything happens to you, what do you do? Return it with a good action. Idfa billati hiya ahsan. Anytime any distress comes to you from amongst the non-Muslims, from amongst your own people, what does Allah say? Idfa billati hiya ahsan. Reject those things that are happening. Reject the oppression. Reject the negativity. Bil hasan, with good deeds, with good actions, with good words, with good akhlaq. What does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mention as a result of you doing consistently good? فَإِذَا الَّذِي بَيْنَكَ وَبَيْنَهُ عَدَاوَى كَأَنَّهُ وَلِيٌّ حَمِيمٌ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that you try this for a while. When someone does bad to you, you do good back to them. When someone insults you, you give them praise. When someone denounces you, you hold them high and honor him. When somebody takes you and doesn't even regard you as a human being, you raise him up and you mention that I love you because Allah has created the best of creation from amongst man. And what will you find in response to this? Allah is saying that I, Allah, promise you that if you do good back, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَإِذَا الَّذِي بَيْنَكَ وَبَيْنَهُ عَدَاوَى. Between the people that you had enmity, كَأَنَّهُ وَلِيٌّ حَمِيمٌ. You will find that they will be your protectors. You will find that they will come to your defense if you are a good person, if you are a person that follows Islam. My dear brothers and elders in Islam, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enable us to do good within our communities, to do good within our families, to do good in response to all of the evil that is happening. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect all of the innocent people around the world from the dhulum of all the zalimeen. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect the lives of the innocent, to protect the lives of the Muslims, the mal of the Muslims, the wealth of the Muslims. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enable us to be ummatun wahida, solidified under the Quran. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enable us to live and to die with the kalima. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enable us to live and to die with the kalima. La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wa ma alayna illa al-balagh. Few minutes for sunnah, inshaAllah.